there are different variants that arrive. There have been a lot of variants that arrive that have gone nowhere, so there have been thousands of variants. It's just we only see the variants that persist, the ones that are fitter, the ones that take the edge off an immune response, the ones that do well in vivo. They're the ones we see and they're the ones we talk about. So in terms of surges and why they may change more than others, so generally what we see in, let's just say, healthy population that may get SARS-CoV-2, 1 to 2 changes in the genome of the virus per month. And that's generally what we saw from early 2020. And that is what we predicted, and that was predicted in the context of other coronaviruses. That's a type of mutational rate that we expected. The thing about surges and when we get big numbers is rare events occur. So rare events in meaning that vulnerable populations may be infected. And we do see more changes when the infection becomes more chronic. So if there's some person, unfortunately, that's immunocompromised, and they can be immunocompromised for a lot of reasons. They might have had cancer, they may be treated for cancer, they might have HIV. A lot of reasons why people are immunocompromised. And previous studies have shown it's in those unfortunate individuals that are infected for a very long time that a lot of more changes can accumulate. So at the end of 2020, we're all talking about, say, the UK variant, which is also known as B117, also the South African variant, B1351, and also the Brazilian variant, which is P1. And they were marked by having more changes than we expected. So instead of seeing 1 or 2 changes, we saw all of a sudden 24 changes in these variants. And these are hypothesized to come out of more chronic infections of immunocompromised individuals, because case studies have shown in those individuals, they're the ones that have been infected for a long time, those mutations accumulated. So in Australia, we essentially sequencing everything now. So there are really great groups, obviously in Victoria, obviously in South Australia and Queensland. There's a whole network of people that do sequencing. So in the UK, obviously, where there's more infections, they do obviously globally the bulk of the sequencing, and hundreds of thousands of sequences have been done by the UK Genomics Consortium that way. So I think that they've done a really great job of giving us a global map of the emerging variants, the variants that are there, the variants that are growing in vivo. But I think in Australia, we've done our job in terms of looking at all of the variants that come into quarantine, and obviously all of the variants that contribute to community spread. And the really important thing with community spread is the sequences can actually help the contact tracers. They can tell, they can go back to the source. They can say this variant has come from this person in quarantine, and this is what led in a spread in the community. And if there are multiple spread events, they can determine that over time. So what colloquially people are turning the Indian variant, and it's just because that was where it's first detected, is a group of viruses with the name B1617. Now that's where it starts, and there are 3 of them. What's really important about the 1617 variants is they're all very different, although their names appear to be look the same, and although we colloquially call them all the Indian variants. So the one we're talking about that's community spread in Melbourne at the moment, that's 1617.1. Okay, that was the first one that grew up or started to expand in India and has spread around the globe, and obviously is in Australia now. Now there's a second one. Now that's the one that's accelerating in India. So that's what it's displacing 0.1, and it's called 0.2. In vitro, in the lab, when we do these experiments, we essentially see that 0.2 or 1617.2 is fitter than 1617.1. So being immune evasive is one thing. So in a vaccinated population, sure, 1617.1 might have an advantage, but in terms of a naive population where we're not vaccinated or we don't have as much vaccine uptake as we should, in places like India where there's a large population and the vaccine rates are low, that's where a naive population to the virus, 1617.2, can really accelerate. So there are kind of continuums with the variants in terms of immune evasion, in terms of fitness. But 0.2, very fit, slightly immune evasive. 0.1, less fit, but more immune evasive. That summarizes it. And 0.3, that's on the horizon, and we don't know a lot about that. I think a lot of the time with variants, we're learning in real time. And I think that we've got to be careful of not drilling down on them too much and getting too scared about them. I think what we've got to think of SARS-CoV-2 is we've got to treat them all the same. until we know otherwise. And I think at the current point in time, there's not a lot of data that can really, so the data that I'm talking about is preliminary. It's being published worldwide and we're all independently corroborating with each other. But it's really important that, you know, we treat them all the same until we get better data sets, greater confidence that, you know, this truly is fit, not only when I see it in vitro, but also fit in the real world in terms of increased transmissibility or in terms of immune evasion. You know, studies like this or with the South Africa, in terms of the vaccine studies, this is one we've got to watch in terms of vaccine evasion or immune evasion.